Good morning and welcome to the first meeting of the Education, Children and Young People Committee in 2024. The first item on our agenda is an evidence session on post-school education and skills reform with the Minister for Further and Higher Education, the Minister for Veterans, Graham Day MSP. It's a pleasure to have you back this morning, Minister. And alongside Mr Day, we have Leslie Ward, Head of Public Bodies Governance and Reform, and Jane Duffy, Post-School Qualifications Unit Head. That's the lighting going down. Welcome all and thank you for your time this morning. Can I invite the Minister to make some brief opening remarks before we move to questions from members? Minister, you've up to 3 minutes. Thanks.
Thank you, Convener, and Happy New Year to everyone. I very much welcome the opportunity to appear before the committee on the subject of the reform agenda, I think not least of all because it affords us an opportunity to explore the topic in far greater detail than last month's statement to the Chamber allowed us to. As I said in making the statement, there are aspects of all of this where we are quite progressed in our thinking, others a bit less so. And I make no apologies for taking time to consider all aspects of what James Willers has called for. I spent the last 6 months or so very much in listening mode. I've wanted to develop more fully my understanding of what works well and what needs to change either dramatically or to a degree to furnish us with a skills and post-16 education landscape that's both agile and fit for the future. I also wanted to look at the practicalities and to interrogate possible unintended consequences in all of this, not to find reason not to proceed, but to ensure that when we do proceed, we have a clear road ahead. Members will, I'm sure, appreciate I hope the more detail that we've gotten into, the more questions that has generated. But I do believe we're now quite well progressed in our thinking and broad planning. That said, I remain very much in listening mode today. If the committee collectively or its individual members have constructive ideas to contribute, then I'm very much open to considering these. And to be clear, we don't need change simply because change is required. What we need is to get the right change delivered and with the correct sequencing. And that overarching element is perhaps the most important one. Some of what will be required will take time, especially those parts requiring legislation or significant repositioning of staff. But I hope that during the statement I was able to indicate some elements of our direction of travel. And I do believe that there is much we can do in the context of decluttering the landscape and refining our offer without having to wait for structural change. But, Convener, I'm here today to answer the questions of the committee and to listen to their ideas on this hugely important and wide-ranging subject, so that's probably enough for me to begin with.
OK, thank you very much for that, Minister. I'll be kicking off this morning, and I suppose it just picks up on some of the things you've said. You've spoken about decluttering the landscape, and it should be the right change with the right sequencing. It all sounds very familiar when you've got all these reviews that are taking place. And we really do want that clear road ahead in terms of the reform. So how will all the recommendations of all the recent reviews be factored in? So what sort of things are you looking at? But also the smaller reviews that have been taking place as well, like the 2020 review of the Scottish Technology Ecosystem, the Entrepreneurial Campus Report, those sorts of smaller, more peripheral reviews. What are your thoughts on that?
I think that's a very good point. I think we're trying to take account of as much of all of that as possible. Some of it is contradictory and therefore we won't proceed with. But there's a lot of common strands through this. And if I give you an example of the gender work that was done by SAB, looking at how we tackle some of the gender discrepancies, particularly in our apprenticeship offering. And what we're going to do with that is instead of deploy that as a standalone piece of that work, take the opportunity to weave that into the reform agenda, because I think that will pay greater dividends rather than being something else that we're going to do. The sequencing of a lot of this can be quite challenging. There are certain things that need to happen to accommodate other things. And that's probably the largest piece of work that the team are developing at the moment, so that when we get to that end game, we've done everything in the right order. And I'm more than happy today to commit, you know, if the committee appreciates this as a complex piece of work, to commit to keep the committee regularly updated as we proceed on that, so the committee has a full understanding of what we're doing and when we're doing it.
So, because James Withers told us back in November that cherry-picking things from reviews would worry him. So it would be good to know where your space is around making sure we're not missing some of the key elements.
So in the context of Withers, one way or another, I would anticipate us taking forward pretty much everything that's in there. There's a number of things that were still, small things that we're still considering the merits of. But overwhelmingly, the piece of work that James Withers did, and you can tell by the reaction of the various elements of the sector to that review, that we understand he's right in what he's calling for, and we're proceeding on the basis that that's what we're looking to deliver.
I mean, he did speak of that North Star of what that successful skills reform should look like. So I'm wondering in terms of how you're going to measure success and define it and how it will be judged. I know that's it's difficult. That's like cart before the horse element almost because we're in that sort of...
Well, I think there's a number of strands to this. There's a lot of structural things we need to do to deliver on the agenda that we have. But essentially what we're about here is making the experience of the learner better than it is currently and to ensure that employers have a better access to the skills that they require to deliver for the economy and to give particularly young people sustainable employment. Those are the ambitions that we have. And I think the judgment will be made in however many years' time then as to how successful we've been in achieving that. But that's one of the reasons that I've taken a bit of time just now, because I think if we look at the unintended consequences, consider the practicalities. Now, we will save time as we move to the implementation phase because we will have determined what the hurdles are that we have to overcome first.
And that's great. And I know I have got a sense of urgency about this, so it would be good to know that there is a timeline that will be available to us, so what we can expect and by when.
So that will be evolving, as you will appreciate. But in the context of timeline, I would, and I'm probably being a bit conservative here in using this particular timeline, but by mid-March, I would hope that we would have some tangible information on the first elements of what we've committed to, which is the things like the consolidation of the apprenticeship funding in one locality, the consolidation of the student support in one locality. I would hope that by mid-March, hopefully at the latest, I'd be able to share publicly what that will look like. As a starting point.
That's helpful to have that timeline in our heads anyway to work towards. Can I ask Michelle Thompson now to take on the question?
Good morning, Minister. Thank you for joining us this morning. Now, I'm fully appreciative of the scale of the challenge that you've got in front of you and the multiple stakeholders. But I wanted to talk to you this morning a wee bit about the role of enterprise agencies in post-school education reform and how you see that working, and in particular reference to workforce planning and that interface to ensure we're getting the skills we need for the future. I wonder if you could give me your thoughts thus far about that.
So if we take the role of the enterprise agencies in the first instance, James Withers, I think, had a view about the lead role they could take on some of the regional planning. I'm not entirely convinced of that as a one-size-fits-all approach at the moment, because as I've travelled around the country over the last 6 months, I've seen instances where I think other entities might be the best lead for that, perhaps the local college, for example. So I'm kind of open-minded as to what form that would take at the moment. That's what I refer back to, I said earlier about there are elements of what Withers has called for that we've not finally made our mind up on. In terms of workforce planning, and I know you will differentiate between workforce planning and skills planning, and I think it's important that we get that on the record, because there's an awful lot of what is talked about is shortage of workforce. It's not the skills element. And we're going through an exercise just now with ministerial colleagues looking or trying to plot what the actual skill shortages are, what form they take. So if we're told, for example, that we're short of 4,000 engineers, my question is, what kind of engineers? So we need to plot that, to map it properly. And that's something that needs to be done at pace. And sitting alongside that, of course, is not simply to do that and then say, well, what do we do about it? What we're looking to do is to have the universities and the colleges in part of that conversation. Because the next question is, well, if those are the shortages, do we have the capacity currently to train the individuals required to meet those skill shortages? And if we don't, how do we go about it? So that's one of the more immediate things that we're doing currently. And there will be geographical differences here. There will be hot spots. Perhaps your own constituency would be one of those, where there's a particular type of demand there that's maybe not the same in other parts of the country. So we are utilising in particular the staff at SDS who've been involved in this work. There's not a lot of them, it has to be said. That's something we'll have to look at. But there's some decent information there that's helping inform our thinking. And that's a particularly active work stream for us at the moment.
That's a very helpful response, thank you. And I think in your opening remarks, you alluded to who might have the best oversight of future requirements. And I suppose, whilst in doing this exercise, one of the challenges we've got is how do we correctly map the gaps here and now today as against what the need is in the future? So can I make the assumption then that in reflecting on who has the best oversight of that, it's that future focus, because that's where we need to almost get ahead of the pack whilst we go through this exercise?
So as part of this exercise, I'm speaking to a lot of employers and sectors. So there are some sectors who will progress themselves on this. They understand their skill shortage. Financial services would be a case in point. So that's helpful because we know what we need to do in that space. But you're absolutely right. There is the current need and there is the future need. And that's where we need, I think, to future-proof what it is we're doing. So if you take, for example, we're told we're short of 600 or 700 planners at the moment. And that's really important because that's the building block of construction and then the economic development that needs to flow from it. But I guess my question is, well, what is the planning degree of the future? Is it the same as the one that we had 5 years ago? Because from my perspective as a layman, we now have far more need for an expertise in marine planning, in aquaculture, etc., etc. So this is an illustration of the exercise we're going through now of saying, well, what is the planning degree of the future? What do we anticipate it will require? Can our universities who are involved in the delivery of this immediately deliver that? If not, how do we equip them to do it? Then there's the question about the critical mass. If we have a need now for 600 or 700 planners, what is the pipeline there? The universities need to know that so they know what's in it for them to provide these courses in whatever locality. And that's part of what we're going through currently.
Right, that's very, very helpful, thank you. And I think you fairly illustrated the complexity around the matter. Now, in terms of the independent skills review, I just want to quote, it highlights the importance of getting the structures and balance of responsibilities within the system right, alongside an agreed vision for success and a shared language. Now, in reality, the report can say that, but all the kind of mix of stakeholder groupings need to be able to buy into that. And there's some real big key words in there: agreed vision for success, shared language, presumably shared outcomes as well, and the structure and balance of responsibility. So I'd appreciate your thoughts about the approach you're taking to pool this multiplicity of stakeholders together to achieve that.
So I think in purpose and principles, we recognise some of this and some of the challenges. Language is important, but I think also the culture that surrounds all of this, the appetite there is for change. It's very easy for people to respond to James Withers and say, yeah, we agree with a lot of that, we need change, and then when it affects them, they're not so keen on it. What I have found, to be fair, largely is a positivity about this, a recognition that this is an opportunity that if we get it right, we can make a huge difference. So, I mean, of course, when you're talking about agencies who have got certain responsibilities currently, there's a bit of overlap. That can be problematic. My job is to pull people into the room and to make sure that we overcome those responsibilities. Now, some of the structural change that we're going to make will help facilitate that because we will consolidate responsibility in one place. But perhaps one of the most important elements of this is the role of employers, because the employer voice, if it's a constructive voice, is going to be critical in this. If what we're getting from employers is, this is what we need, and this is the role we would like to play in ensuring this happens as opposed to simply demanding, and that's what we're seeing at the moment, then I think we've got a real chance to facilitate this. I've got a round table coming up, and it's not just a talking shop with employers shortly, and that's probably a bit of a stock take to see where we've come so far, see what more we need to do. But my approach is very much trying to get the right people in the room at the same time, go back to this thing about the universities and the colleges being in the room as we discuss what the skill shortages actually are. Because instead of then somebody then has to go and talk to universities and colleges, let's just get on and do it. That's the approach we're taking. I'm not going to pretend it's simple and straightforward. It isn't. It is a big challenge. But I do think the appetite is there now to seize this opportunity, because for universities and colleges there is an opportunity to better align their offering with the needs of the economy, and there are financial benefits to them from that. It makes them more sustainable. But at all times we need to be driven by the need to improve the opportunity for our young people and for those who are retraining and upskilling within the current workforce.
And is it fair to characterise it, given approach, that you are creating a new culture of engagement? I mean, what you're describing to me is a considerable amount of engagement, which is time consuming. I appreciate that. Are you consciously undertaking changing culture within your engagement?
Yeah, I think it is time consuming. There's no doubt about that. But it's been essential to commit that time and to listen, because one of the things that has come out of all of this is that some of the really good ideas that we're picking up are coming from the staff in the agencies, for example. Now, some of these agencies were criticised by Withers. You know, we can't shirk from that. And that has stung for some of them. But what I've found amongst the staff is when we've said to them, OK, what would you do differently? Never mind what Withers has said, or is there something we could do there we could take further, do a bit differently? And we started to get some good thoughts coming out. And I was at the SQA yesterday, for example, chatting to the staff, and they threw one or two things at us that have been quite thought-provoking. So that's helping as well. And it goes back to that thing about the largely overwhelmingly positive vibe that we've got around this, that people want to seize this opportunity to make things better.
Okay. Thank you.
Thank you. Ross Greer, you've got some supplementary on this sort of thing.
Yeah, thanks, Commissioner. Just following on from that line of questioning, Minister, I think you've mentioned in the past, James Withers certainly has, the potential role, or the potentially greater role for the private sector in funding courses to meet the skills demand in their area. You've outlined to Michelle Thompson the extent of engagement that you've been doing over recent months and the broad level of the appetite for greater engagement. How much of those conversations have gone into the realm of direct private sector funding for the courses that address those skill shortages in their sectors?
So I probably want to take the opportunity to make clear this is not privatisation in any way, shape or form. What I found, without a lot of prompting for myself, sometimes with no prompting, is a recognition from employers that they are asking for something more. And that they are willing, if they can get that, to support their businesses, to contribute. Now, we should recognise that many employers now currently contribute to the system quite markedly in a variety of ways, not just financially. But there is certainly in the space, I think, where we may be looking for more short, sharp training courses, qualifications that will allow them to upskill their existing workforce. I'm finding a large number of employers saying, and we're up for playing our part in that, contributing to it, and that will be useful, because the public purse is under great pressure, as we all know, and to be able to tap into those additional funding streams where everyone will benefit from them, I think it's going to be incredibly important.
How does a business who needs a particular skill set, needs workers with that skill set, how do they go about doing that? Is this something that you envisage would be a direct relationship between them and their local college?
Yes.
Does it involve the SFC? Because no. I think for some businesses, they won't know where to start. They won't know who to speak to. Should they speak to the college? Should they write to you?
Well, we should acknowledge the fact that in some instances, those relationships already exist. There are some colleges that are embedded in their communities and great relationships. West Lothian College is an example, where they have those relationships with employers already, and those can be developed further. I can't sit today and say we've got a vision of how this will work in practice, but as we look at the regional skills planning model, that should provide the platform or the opportunity for the employers, Chamber of Commerce, and the colleges, universities, whatever, to have that dialogue directly. And that's where we have to strike the balance between national planning for skills and workforce and the regional need, because very often it will be at a regional and very local level.
Thanks very much.
Thank you. Ben McPherson now.
Thanks, Convener. Good morning, Minister, to your officials. Just want to pick up briefly on some of the points that have been made around employers. Thanks for relaying to us about the roundtable that you're going to have with employers. And I know that they're from my constituency casework, that skills planning is something that's of real pertinence to a number of employers in these considerations. So following from that roundtable, have you considered how you continue to get that skills planning expertise from employers into the considerations around how to respond to the needs of employers and make sure there is the access to skills in the short, medium and long term that you talked about?
Mm-hmm. So we are still in the foothills of some of this, and we need to strike a balance between sectoral skills planning and geographical skills planning, so there will be and there is a difference there. So I think the principal conduit that we envisage will be the staff that are currently sitting in SDS on skills planning, because I think, to be fair, there's been more preparatory work done around skills planning than I probably thought when we started to look at this. It's been more the implementation. What do we do with that planning, with the data that lies behind it? And we're going to have to engage more closely with individual sectors to ascertain the need, and then develop a model from that works in each sort of locality. So you may have one of the challenges is the smaller businesses in all of this. What is it that they need set against a major employer that maybe has 100 staff that they want to train in a particular direction? So I'm not going to sit and say today that we are well progressed in all of this. We're still working through that, but we're alive to the point that you make.
Thanks, Minister. That was really helpful. In the previous answers and opening remarks, you talked about how, quite rightly in my view, giving consideration to all the different recommendations and taking the appropriate time to both respond to and implement them. We did hear from Mr. Withers on the 15th of November that he would be concerned if there was a cherry-picking of elements of the review. Certainly, that's not the indication that I've got from you today, but I think it would be helpful for Parliament if you confirmed that a cherry-picking approach isn't how the government intends to proceed. And just in order to give clarity to Parliament in due course, once you've taken the appropriate time to consider all the recommendations, will the Scottish Government set out its response to each of the recommendations? And if so, when approximately should we anticipate that?
I recognise that perhaps the approach I've taken to this has lent itself to that fear about cherry picking, because I didn't do the kind of standard government response and said, here are the recommendations and here what we're saying about them. And I didn't do that because, one, I thought it was more important to get on with this, and two, we really needed to get into the nitty gritty around some of his recommendations. I would say that overwhelmingly we will end up doing what James Withers has called for, absolutely overwhelmingly. But there may be elements of it that are tweaked slightly because we've gotten into this in a bit more detail. We've perhaps identified unintended consequences that James hadn't seen. That doesn't mean we won't do what he's looking for. We may have to do it in a slightly different way. We may go further in our expectations in some of these areas. So we are quite progressed in our thinking, if I put it that way, very well progressed in that. We're now moving more into the planning to deliver phase. And if the committee would find it useful for us to respond, kind of summarising where we've gotten to in all of this, then I'd be happy to do that in due course and write to the committee on it. One thing I would say, we touched on earlier there about employers and about the role of employers in this. There is another element here I think that would benefit everyone, and that is developing the offering around work experience for young people. So I've seen examples going around the country. I was in Shetland last year, and DYW are providing, well, pre-pandemic, providing meaningful work experience for every pupil at the local secondary school. They expect to be back in that position later this year. And I think that's incredibly important, because if a young person is thinking about a career and they can get an opportunity to go and test that thinking, it may be that they are absolutely enthused to carry on and do it. It may be they're put off and they change their mind. That's better for the would-be employer, it's better for the system, and it's better for the young people, because we do need to drive down the attrition rates, the failure rates that we have in all elements of the post-16 landscape. And if we can develop that offering around the work experience, and a number of employers do this, then I think that will help us moving forward. And that's one of the asks I have of employers, whether that be in the public sector or the private sector. If you can provide a meaningful work experience for the young people who are thinking about a career with yourselves or with a similar company or industry, then please step forward and offer us that opportunity. And I think through the new career setup, I hope we have the mechanism to deliver that.
It certainly sounds like a good way to progress, and empathetic to the points made around wanting to take appropriate time and to test for unintended consequences, and the offer to write to the committee. And I would just request on top of that, perhaps, you know, once you reach a conclusion on all the recommendations, even if recommendations are being rejected or implemented in a different way, I think it would be helpful for Parliament to know the reasoning why on every recommendation.
Yeah. I should say that a lot of this is being tested at the moment with the relevant stakeholders. So, you know, some of the work we're doing directly with the colleges around their role in all of this. They've taken away some of that to work through, and they're coming back to us with thinking in that area. The universities are coming forward with thoughts as well. So it's very much a work in progress. But I do want to stress that we've taken that 6 months to do the listening and the talking, whatever. We are now very much moving into the delivery phase.
Thank you. And just another question, Minister. If thinking about what you said about taking time, James Withers has said a 10-year timescale for post-school reform is not unrealistic in his view, but that results will not be seen quickly, and I think it's important for everyone to appreciate that, and that this could could impact momentum potentially. So I'd just be interested in what's being done by the Scottish Government to build consensus politically across the sector, and how will momentum be maintained? You talked rightly about how the review has been widely embraced across different stakeholders, but how do we keep that going?
So I think, understandably, there was a scepticism when the review came out, because, you know, there have been previous reviews that have gathered dust on the shelf, have not been acted upon immediately. So I understand that scepticism that was there. I hope we've removed that over these last few months by the kind of momentum I've tried to put into this. And I think momentum is the key word here. We need to just build that so that this people are clear it's going to happen and they get on board. In terms of the political consensus, I have to say, I pay tribute to colleagues across the political spectrum. I've had a lot of direct engagement on a one-to-one basis with colleagues from multiple political parties who've given me their thoughts, offered ideas, which have been incredibly helpful. There are things we will disagree on an approach, and that's perfectly appropriate. But I think there is a political consensus about the need to seize this opportunity, which I very much welcome. And my door remains open to anyone who wants to come and offer us their thoughts. As for this timescale, I would be very disappointed if we did not see considerable change long before 10 years from now. I think James was right in that he was talking about there would need to be structural change, it would require primary legislation. That will no doubt spill into the next Parliament to deliver on some of this. But this is about setting a direction of travel now. And that's what we're trying to do. I'm trying to be very clear about the kind of things that we can do without waiting to change the badging or the labelling of organisations, essential though that will be. And I do think that over the next period, there is an opportunity, in terms of this Parliament alone, we may have an opportunity to get some primary legislation that we'll need through in this Parliament. But I think the MO of some of what we do here needs to change and can change quite quickly. Now, there are very substantial challenges, one of which has emerged around the qualifications landscape. So we're going to need a lot more short, sharp qualifications that need to be affirmed. We will need a qualifications body in charge of that is agile. But over the years, we've built up a bank of qualifications, many of which do not get utilised now. And we're going to have to go through an exercise, and it will take a few years to remove those because they're no longer utilised, they're no longer necessary. It's part of decongesting the landscape. So if someone says, I have a thought to follow this type of job opportunity, what are the qualifications open to me, then it'll be much clearer to them what they are, what the value of them are. So there's that type of exercise will need to take place that perhaps feeds into that kind of 10-year horizon that James talks about. But I do think there's a much shorter horizon we should be aiming at to see meaningful change coming through.
Absolutely, and I think as well that the way that enthusiasm has been expressed for giving such qualifications parity of esteem has gathered quite a lot of acceleration since the publication of the review, and that all lends us in the right direction.
But it's easy to talk about that. I mean, everyone talks about parity of esteem, but we actually need to deliver it, and that's going to require a cultural change. It's also going to require us to help parents, who are major influences of young people when they come to make their choice, to recognise that an apprenticeship is no less a future than a university qualification. That's not taking anything away from university qualifications. And one of the things I think we really do need to do is to ban the word vocational, because we talk about vocational qualifications. Why do we differentiate between academic and vocational? The minute you do it, you kind of make people go, is that lesser? What is it? And it's a simple thing to say, but I think we need to watch our language. We talked earlier about the language of this. Going to college and training to be a joiner or a plumber or whatever is no less a positive destination than going to university. And we need all of us to watch our language around that if we're going to change this view of the career openings that are there for our young people.
I'd absolutely endorse that. And you know, just in my experience of people I've grown up with who've going on in different directions, there's absolutely a need to change the public consciousness around that, and look forward to collaborating with the government on that. Just lastly, people who become joiners or plumbers, just to use your example, Minister, often have an interest in many other things as well, of course, and the arts is something that's under challenge in other parts of the UK. Some degrees are being talked about or avenues of study or human knowledge are being discussed by some politicians as of less value than more practical qualifications. And I've thought for some time that it would benefit our society and also individuals in their learning journey and in the wider lives if some of these could be combined, practical skills with an area of the arts that somebody might want to engage in, whether that's a language or a creative aspect like art history or something like that. Has that ever been considered by the government? I mean, it's not mentioned in the review, but to me it's an issue that is of pertinence at this time.
I've got to confess, it's not something that we've considered. I've got enough on my plate without taking on more. But I think our universities will always be thinking about these things. They're pretty creative places, and they realise that the challenges that they face currently will require them to develop new offerings. Now, for example, graduate apprenticeships, I think, will come to the fore more and more, but there will always be the emphasis on the arts and various other things in our universities. And if they choose to offer combined degrees, if you want to call them that, in these areas because they believe there is a need for them, then I'm sure they will. I mean, I would say one thing as well about the apprenticeship scheme, because I've certainly come across a number of very rounded young people who have been developed under the modern apprenticeship scheme, not just in terms of the skills they've learned, but in a wider sense. I visited an aerospace company in Ayrshire, and every single person who showed me around that day had come through the apprenticeship programme. They were amazing young people. The young women who are going into the schools to try and entice women into engineering were incredibly impressive young people. They were being developed not only the skill set to be engineers, but as individuals as well. And that's something I think we should look to the apprenticeship programme to do a bit more of as well.
Thank you. Can I back a little bit, Mr. Day, before we move on to other members, to the micro-credentials that you were speaking about, because they've been spoken about in 2020, 21, indeed in our report in 23. The colleges have been looking for these for quite some time. So what and or who has been letting them down? And when is it in the role of the SQA, or is it going to be a new body that will be involved? Again, that's maybe the wider reform agenda. So I'm interested on your thoughts on that.
I can't talk for what was happening prior to my coming into the post. I can only talk about what I'm seeing currently. And if we have not met the ask of employers in that regard, there will be a variety of reasons. Some colleges may not have had the capacity to do that, for example. But that is the growth area, and it's an area we're going to have to move into. And that's the conversation currently that's taking place with colleges and with employers about how we do this. But you're right to raise the question about the micro-credentials, because they have to be of a sufficiently high standard to be credible. Mm-hmm. And that's an exercise we have to go through as well. How do we deliver those? How do we become agile in that space while maintaining the credibility and integrity of the qualifications? And the other thing we need to look at is to ensure that whatever qualifications we are offering are not so narrow, so very narrow, that individuals are basically getting a course that's only applicable to the company they currently work for. So there's an element of that as well. So I said we've progressed in a lot of areas. That's one that's still under consideration.
Thanks. And just picking up again on something that Ben McPherson said, by not setting out a full response to each of the Withers recommendations, could be harder to therefore chart progress against his report. So will the Scottish Government be mapping out progress against its own outcomes in that case?
Do you want to come on, Leslie?
Leslie Ward.
Thanks, Convener. Yes, in setting out the purpose and principles and the initial priorities within that back in June, which was sort of accepting the broad general direction of travel set by James Withers, we've set outcomes for the system and we'll be measuring our progress against delivery of those outcomes. We're absolutely able to track through from the Withers recommendations to the work we're taking forward under the auspices of the purpose and principles, and we'll be able to make that clear for the committee and in the longer term as we chart that progress through.
I know we'll be very interested in that progress, Leslie Ward, so thank you for that commitment. Ross Greer, can I come back to yourself now? Thank you.
Thanks very much, Convener. Excuse me. Minister, I'm interested in, again, going back to the level of engagement that you've done since coming into post, what the response has been to the publication of the purpose and principles statement and the framework surrounding that. Do you get an initial sense of, particularly for colleges and universities themselves, is that the level of direction they were expecting? You'll be familiar as a former member of this committee with the evidence that we took from colleges in particular who were really crying out for a sense of direction from government. They wanted to know what it was they were supposed to be doing. Purpose and principles was supposed to be, not all of that, but certainly the first step towards that. What's the response been like since its publication?
Can I start with this?
So I think it's firstly important to say that Purpose and Principles was developed in partnership with stakeholders from across the entirety of the education skills system and was the first attempt really to look at the entirety of the system and try and bring together outcomes and a purpose and principles that could be applicable to independent training providers as much as colleges and universities. I think in that sense, you're right, there's a level of that's perhaps not granular enough for perhaps day-to-day planning, but I think as you look at the purpose and principles setting the context for the strategic and operational plans of the Funding Council of Skills Development Scotland and others who are supporting funds into our colleges and setting clear outcome agreements and those types of things that will apply to sectors and to individual institutions, you can see the translation through. And that was always our intent with the purpose and principles, that it would serve as a kind of golden thread that can run through and aggregate up to the National Performance Framework as well and the outcomes we want to see for Scotland as a whole.
But it's important that the implementation of all of that is done in partnership. And that's why we have tried, for example, the establishment of the tripartite group with the colleges, to have that kind of platform where we can discuss all of this in detail. Because, you know, we can have the overarching principles here and the direction of travel, but actually to deliver it will require the buy-in of the colleges, the universities, whoever. And we need their input. They will understand best how that can be put into practice. So we're trying to have that much better partnership approach and the ability to say, well, wait a minute, if we did it this way, it would be more productive. And we're in the early days of that, but I think that's how we're going to take this forward.
Response from employers, trade associations, trade unions, etc. I know that particularly EIS, FILA, UCU, etc., they were all engaged in the process. Has there been much response from them since publication?
So I think we continue to engage with all of the unions, and in particular, given the level of structural change that's mooted in the responses, particularly those unions that represent people working across the public bodies as well. But we continue to engage with UCU, EIS, FILA on the development of the purpose and principles and how we take forward the implementation of recommendations in the Withers Review as well.
How do we measure the success? How do we measure the outcomes from it? Because as you say, it's the kind of golden thread running through a lot of other stuff, particularly most obviously the outcome agreements for the colleges, but plenty of other strategic documents, SFC, organisational strategy as well. And it's relatively clear in terms of the long-term outcomes what we measure this against eventually, but a year from now, 2 years from now, by the end of this parliamentary session, when this committee is drafting its legacy report, how are we to measure at that point, and how are you measuring on that ongoing short and medium term basis what the outcome has been? Is this resulting in that clearer sense of direction, that greater clarity around strategic objectives, without thinking, right, we'll come back to it in 10 years and see whether it worked?
No, absolutely. And one of the things that we're doing and committed to doing is continually publishing evidence as we develop it and conclude it. So just before the Christmas recess, we published an evidence paper that sets out where, against the outcomes that we've set for the system through the purpose and principles, we have solid evidence of our ability to measure and meet those outcomes. We were required to develop further evidence because one of the challenges that we have here, as you'll well know, is the comparability across different types of pathway of different types of outcomes. So we're recognising and starting to unpick and understand where we have gaps in the evidence that we need in order to adequately measure the progress that we're making. So we'll continue to develop that. We're doing that in partnership with both our public bodies and with institutions and representatives across the sectors as well. And that will be a work in progress that we'll continue to do. So we won't leave it for 10 years and then come back and look at it. We'll continue to evolve that. And we're certainly setting short, medium and longer term outcomes that we want to achieve.
That point around data and where the gaps in the evidence are is certainly quite interesting. That's been a running theme, not just for this committee, but across the board in Parliament, of where there are kind of key gaps in the data that we need to measure success. In a lot of ways, we're gathering huge amounts of data, but not necessarily what we actually need. How are you, I realise this is a little bit meta, but how are you reporting on that? How are you identifying? Because I think Parliament would be interested to know where you've identified that there are gaps in the evidence that you need before we get to the stage of publishing a report on what the outcomes have been, we would be quite interested to know what, where you've identified those gaps actually are and then how that can be addressed.
So I think some of that is picked up in the report that we published just before Christmas. So it sets out where we have a high level of confidence, where there are gaps in the data and where we feel that we've got considerable work to do to develop things. And just to say that there are joint working groups that are looking at the data that is available across different public bodies, what's collected for different purposes and how best to utilise that to best effect.
Thanks very much.
Okay, thank you. Can I come over to Bill Kidd now, please? Thanks.
Thank you very much, convener. It's been interesting, and a couple of things I was thinking of asking have pretty much been stood on already, but doesn't do any harm just to sort of go over things a wee bit again. Minister, on the 5th of December last year, you said a tripartite group, and I think you mentioned that earlier, between the government, the Scottish Funding Council and college principals have been established to improve engagement amongst them. How has the impact actually benefited those in education, please?
I guess at the risk of passing the buck, you might want to ask them that question if they feel it's been beneficial. I think they would say it has been. I should also say I think the benefit has been seen from the perspective of the universities as well, who've asked if we would set a similar group up to engage with them directly. I think that platform has proved to be helpful. It's probably taken longer than I expected to start to pay the dividends I would have hoped for. But as an opportunity to have very full and frank discussions about key topics that the colleges feel they would benefit from if we took a different approach. So having the SFC there to discuss the nuts and bolts of that has been very helpful. There's been a number of meetings so far, some of which I've attended, some of which I haven't been able to get to. Been a number of areas where we've progressed things. But I think more than anything, it was about developing a better collective understanding of the perspectives around the table. And I'll give an example of that. Prior to setting up the tripartite group, the colleges had asked for flexibilities around their credit targets. So they wanted the same money, but a bit of flexibility as to how they used it. And that flexibility was granted in part, but it wasn't as fully utilised as one might have expected or hoped. And a lot of that was down to a lack of understanding of what that meant in reality on both sides, and a lack of explanation. And essentially, they'd asked for a one-size-fits-all approach that didn't entirely suit all of the individual colleges. So there's been a bit of a shift here, so that what we're looking at is, if there is an ask from the sector, it's an ask that's fully understood, can be fully deployed, and it suits the interests of the majority. And that's been the way in which this has been taken forward. So there's a number of areas that we've been looking at in terms of increased credit flexibilities, the timescales and the timings of decision-making. Some of the decisions that were made by the SFC didn't align with the timetable that the colleges worked for. Seems like a simple thing to fix. It hasn't been entirely simple, but we're getting there. And the disposal of assets is something that we've been looking at quite closely. So because of Treasury rules and various other things, there has not been a driver for colleges to dispose of assets they don't need for a purpose of investing in the fabric of their buildings and whatever. And we're still working through an option to where we could facilitate that, and it would allow them to move forward. There's an enthusiasm on the colleges' part that we get to an end point on that, which is what we're working towards. But moving forward, a lot of what's brought forward to discuss is actually driven by the colleges. They have a number of asks, a number of suggestions. What I'd like to do is, with the agreement of all of the parties, when we get to the point where there's some very tangible return on this, that we could write to committee jointly and explain what it has delivered. I think that would be useful. But I would need the agreement of the other parties to do that.
Okay, no, that would certainly would be helpful for us, and it's good that you're saying that there has been, you know, a good blending together and working together. So I take it then that university and college principal representation on the ministerial group on education and skills reform has been beneficial also.
So you mean that what I talked about introducing the statement, well, that hasn't happened yet.
No,
what we've done is we've been extended an invitation to the principals groups of both the colleges and the universities to put forward the appropriate individuals, and they may change depending on what we're exploring, so that the practitioner's voice is heard loud and clear in the room for the Cabinet Secretary's benefit. I can't tell you who will be involved. It will be up to them who they want to put forward. But I think it's incredibly important that we have that representation in there to put forward their thoughts and their ideas and help drive this in the right way.
Okay. Well, that certainly sounds, that makes a lot of sense and something that college and uni principals might want to be involved in anyway. Would there be further education, higher education union representation also being considered for this?
That hasn't been considered at this stage, but it's a fair ask. I had a useful conversation with STUC a couple of months ago where within the public sector bodies, we are quite well engaged with the trade unions. I met with them myself. We're obviously engaged with the staff cohort. So there's an opportunity to feed in not only their ideas but their concerns. I was asked about, in the context of employer engagement that we've talked about earlier, that we try to ensure that the voice of the staff was heard within that. And I think that's a fair point, which I'm kind of mulling over how we do that. The employers in the room at the time heard that as well. But it's a good point, because very often the best ideas are coming from the people who work at the coalface of companies, not just the management. So that is something we need to develop. In terms of direct involvement, that isn't something we've taken forward, but it's something I'll take away and consider.
Well, that would be great. And thank you very much for that then. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Kidd. Willie Rennie, please.
The Minister knows that I broadly welcomed his statement in December. I thought it was a pragmatic bit of progress. Other members have pressed you on timing already, so I'm not going to go over that again, other than to say, I think, you know, we didn't start from here. This reform has been a long time coming, and it culminated in quite a critical report from Audit Scotland about the lack of leadership. So there is a certain degree of urgency. I understand what he says, and we've got to get this right, but I hope that he appreciates that when he publishes timeline, perhaps in March, that there will be pressure and expectation for this to be delivered as promptly as possible, because it's going to have a real tangible impact. And it's the tangible impact I want to explore just a little bit. The single source of funding, it sounds neat and tidy, but what tangible benefits will there be of having that single source of funding on the whole skills agenda?
So one of James Willis' legitimate criticism of the landscape as it currently exists is there are so many different funding sources. And that can be open to exploitation as well. And also a bureaucracy that grows up around that. So if you're a college and you've got 70, 80 different funding sources that you can draw down from, you rightly have to account for how you spent that money. So a huge bureaucracy grows up in a college around just dealing with that. If we can strip that out, albeit with the right safeguards in place, because this is public money, and allow the colleges to get on with doing what they're meant to be doing, that will be helpful. So I think there's a tangible benefit there. There is also a greater transparency for ourselves as parliamentarians around how this money is spent. I think both of those are important. James called for this based on his conversations with employers, with colleges, with universities. So there was a good backdrop to what he has asked for. I don't think it's a magic wand that's suddenly going to make everything wonderfully better. I don't suggest it is. But I think it's a useful step. Now, he wanted to move to a single funding body. I think that, apart from the legislative aspects of that, I think that is quite a leap in one go. And that's why I've indicated we're going to do this in stages. We're going to consolidate the apprenticeship funding in one locality, the student funding in another. Perhaps the former is more important than the latter in real terms. That will allow us to take, and bear in mind, in some instances, we will have staff having to transfer across under 2p in order to deliver that. That's why it takes a bit of time. It's not because I want it to take time, it just does. That will allow us to look at that, to deliver on that, and I think that will give us the springboard to then move on to what James has called for, recognising, of course, that the universities have expressed some concerns themselves about a single funding body that we need to address.
So just reflect just briefly on that. You don't think you will threaten the charitable status of universities with this reform? You're going to make sure that that doesn't happen?
Well, I've talked earlier about taking time to avoid unintended consequences. That's one that has been flagged to us. We're not as convinced it's as legitimate a concern in reality as the universities do, but we respect the view that they have expressed. And of course we will take that on board, because that would be counterproductive if we were to do something like that.
Can I just move on briefly to Shetland College? You'll have seen, you've been involved, but there's been some redundancies announced recently. I want to know what you're doing to try and protect provision in Shetland. But secondly, the cost base for rural provision, particularly the Highlands and Islands, is much greater than it would be in the Central Belt. And I met recently with the principal of the new UHI for North West and Hebrides to discuss their provision. Could you just set out what we're doing to make sure that the provision in the Highlands and Islands is protected, recognising the higher base of costs?
So I have myself directly engaged with UHI about the future of UHI as an entity. I also met with the individual college principals as well. The concept of UHI is absolutely committed to. But we recognise, all of us collectively recognise, that it will have to evolve to meet some of the challenges that are there. UHI internally are doing a substantial piece of work to consider what that would look like. It's a piece of work that recognises that even within UHI, the cost base of delivering in some localities will be higher than others. You know, island settings, for example. I visited the college and met with the principal that you're referring to as well. I was in Shetland and met the principal there. Specific to Shetland and to other elements of UHI, there has been additional support provided by SFC over a period of time, recognising some of the challenges that exist. I know that SFC are very much alive to the situation at Shetland. But that doesn't mean that colleges, any college, can continue in an unsustainable way in the long term. Colleges have to become sustainable for their own good, or more sustainable for their own good, whilst recognising the additional costs. So we're very much alive to that. I know SFC are directly engaged with Shetland College. They work very closely over the merger for the other college that you refer to. It is right and proper that in the interest of the public bus, we expect the colleges to become as sustainable as possible. And I absolutely, you know, stand by that. But there is, of course, a recognition of the additional costs. What we need to see is more of what is already happening in UHI, where between individual colleges, for example, there is considerable collaboration, recognising that you might not be able to deliver every discipline in every specific locality. And it may be that some apprentices will travel from, as they do currently, from Shetland to Inverness for some of the training. But then Shetland perhaps becomes more of an aquaculture centre, for example. So there's already pieces of work going on between the colleges up there to help deliver this. And of course, we also need to develop and grow the university offering in the Highlands. You know, we need these centres to be moving more into the delivery of higher education courses than they currently we are. So we very much see, we have a commitment to the future of UHI, but I do say to you, we do need to see elements of it become more sustainable in the long term.
Sorry.
Duncan Clancy, you've got a supplementary on this thread.
Thanks. Thank you, Convener, and thank you, Minister, and Happy New Year. Just a very quick question. Will the new funding body have non-departmental public body status?
I think the answer is it's too early to say at the moment. So we are fully considering and exploring a range of options, and we're at the exploration of options stage. And the issues that the Minister's rightly pointed up and that University of Scotland have highlighted would be one of the elements under consideration that may well knock something out that is a non-departmental public body, that is a not non-departmental public body. Can't have too many negatives. So, for example, an executive agency would be one of a long list of options, but maybe ruled out on the grounds that we're talking about, because it might compromise, or it could be a risk that it might compromise the ONS classification of universities. So that might be something that would rule it out of a long list of options. But that's the stage that we're at currently.
OK, thank you.
Reviewing some of those unintended consequences. Exactly. OK, thank you. Can I now come to my Vice Convener, Ruth McGuire?
Thank you, Convener. Good morning, Minister and your officials. The Independent Skills Review recommended the Scottish Apprenticeship Advisory Boards should be wound up to aid the mainstreaming of apprenticeships. Minister, are you in a position to respond to this recommendation today at all?
This has come up a few times, and the answer is that that is a recommendation that we will follow through on. Not because SAB hasn't done good work, because it has. I touched on earlier the fantastic work that they did in the gender space that we will take forward. But because I think, as James Withers recognised, I think we need to broaden out the employer's voice in the apprenticeship space. So I've had direct conversations with the Federation of Small Business, for example. I wanted to see how we can better expand the offering to their members. Now, there's a bit of a contradiction here. You know, there are SDS figures that show that there is a very large number of apprenticeships are placed with SMEs, and yet the Federation of Small Business tell me very few of their members have ever had an apprentice. Now, we're not looking to completely rebalance this, but I do think there's something there we need to look at. And there's a relevance here, particularly to rural areas, and shared apprenticeship models. Now, the pilots that were on previously didn't, unfortunately, work out. But I touched on earlier about some ideas that we hear from the staff and some of the agencies, and they've come forward with an idea that might allow us to look at this again. And there are employers who've quite significant employers sometimes who've rightly or wrongly felt excluded from all of this. What we're trying to do is to ensure we have the full range of employers' voices helping inform this going forward. So whilst on the one hand, yes, we will follow that recommendation, I would envisage quite a lot of the people who currently participate in SAB continuing to have a say both on a local and national level and an input to our thinking on particularly around skills delivery.
Thank you, that's helpful. Can I ask about the work of the Careers Collaborative and how that will fit into post-school reform plans?
Yeah, I'm probably the bit of this, all of this that excites me most is the opportunity in that space. Graham Smith has led some really good work, and I'm delighted that he's agreed to continue in this role for us to help develop this further. But I think the Careers Collaborative was seen as something that just pulled things together a bit and talked these things through and produced the report. I actually think there is scope here to develop that approach quite markedly. My thinking at the moment about the careers offering to our young people is that umbrella, that overarching umbrella that makes sure that we have everybody doing their thing, but there's no one falling through the cracks. So at the moment, you've got the SDS Delivered Career Service, fantastic staff doing wonderful work. I think they probably need a different MO, as to how they operate, and it is resource intensive, I recognise that. Then you've got DYW doing really good things. Then you've got things like Career Ready, you've got Enable. There's various strands here that are delivering for young people, but it's maybe been the offering has been a bit narrow because we've focused in on people who have been identified that we think will need support. And actually, there are young people who we've kind of assumed that, you know, they'll be good to make up their own minds, etc., etc. What I've heard talking to young people who've gone through the system is that isn't necessarily the case. Now, I've seen fantastic stuff going on from Edinburgh to Shetland. There's some really good stuff in Dundee, which has informed my thinking about what it is we need to deliver here. And currently, Graham's talking to Jane and her team. We're trying to make sure that what his report called for, because it largely aligns with our vision, but not entirely, how we mesh the two together and then how we take this forward. Because I think at the moment, our careers offering is not what I would want it to be. Because I think we need to get to the place where, for a young person, there is that conversation about, well, what are your interests? What are your skills? Here are your options. Because I don't think we've done that well enough up till now. And I think that's been particularly the case for young women. A lot of young women have followed traditional career paths and perhaps missed out on things that they've got the skill set and would really enjoy. And that's not about being prescriptive and directing young people to particular career paths, but I keep repeating to people about a conversation I had with a young apprentice who said to me that his experience had been one of that had not helped him because he had parental pressure to go to university, but he really wanted to be an apprentice. And what he said was, what we need as young people is to be told, here are the options and here's what they lead to. If you take an apprenticeship, this is what it means. X number of years, this is the kind of salary you'll earn. If you go to college, that's what the qualification will enable you to do. If you go to university, he also added they would want to know how much money they were going to make. And, you know, we should listen to that. But also, I think there's that parental element in all of this that we need to perhaps do more with parents if they are that major influence on young people's career choices, to help them to understand, it's back to the point about parity of esteem, to understand that an apprenticeship can lead to a very fulfilling and successful career. So I think all of this feeds into the mix here. We're currently, as I say, Graham and the team are talking about what this would look like, taking it forward. And this is maybe one area where we can do this without the structural change that needs to come. Because we are the team, the substantial careers team, currently sits within SDS. We have a decision to make about that's where it stays, or it gets rebranded as, you know, it's back to being Careers Scotland or whatever, and I'm not setting hairs running, but these are the thought processes. But in the meantime, we can actually just get on and start to do this in our schools. And that will, it will require the support of local authorities and schools. We will need that culture in our schools. I've seen phenomenal stuff going on in Harris Academy in Dundee, for example, where you've got a fantastic head teacher who has embraced this. He's invested his PEF money in additional guidance teachers to help facilitate this. They have got a near 98% positive destination set of results. So we can do this. It's a big ask. But I think in this space, we can get on and do a lot of this whilst we do all the background stuff to actually put these in place. And it's one of the reasons why I'm being so keen to support DYW and all their third sector partners in the work that they're doing on the ground, particularly with young people from disadvantaged backgrounds. And I mentioned earlier about employers and the unsung work that they're doing. If you, any of you have seen Career Ready in action, what a testimony that is to our employers and to their staff. Some amazing stuff going on there, particularly, you know, I saw that in Glasgow in particular. We need to support that, but we need to map it as well to see where the gaps are and what we're doing to support young people into work and then try and make sure we get this right.
Yeah, I think that's an encouraging response, and I'd certainly endorse that skill sets can lead you on various paths, and it's good to not be too narrow with our young people. And I guess also that learning's lifelong, and if people, young people, wish to pursue academic routes later on in their life, that's an option to them as well. It's not you pick something and then that's you, which it leads me on to my next question. I guess, can I ask about the review of community learning and development and what you hope to achieve with that?
So essentially, I spent the last 6 months really listening, and I've had a lot of detailed feedback on most of this. But I've struggled to get a full picture on the CLD offering right across the country. I know there are areas where it's really good. And I've spoken to people who've gone through that and benefited. Some of them simply develop life skills, and that's important. But also people who've had the opportunity to then go on to college and to get into meaningful employment. And we cannot leave people behind. I'm not satisfied currently that I have the full picture of what's happening. And whilst I know most people, I do it myself, roll your eyes at the thought of not another review, I thought it was important to do this so that as we take forward the overall reform, we fully understand what's happening for that cohort, be they young people who have struggled in the school environment and have fallen through the cracks, or be they that bit older, but could still have the opportunity to get into to work. So we've set the review running, we've given it pretty broad criteria, and we've tasked Kate with coming back to us with, to tell us exactly what she believes the picture is out there. We will clearly look to act upon that alongside COSLA, who we're doing this jointly with. But throughout all of the reform piece, it's clear there are opportunities for elements of you know, the colleges or whatever, but there are also challenges for all of them. And one of my challenges for the colleges will be, can you satisfy us that your pathways are readily accessible for people who are identified through CLD, helped, and then can seamlessly move into college courses if that's what would best suit them? And I know in many, many cases they are there, but I want to be satisfied that that offering, rural settings would be a case in point. Is it different in rural settings? I just want to be more assured than I am currently about what we're doing in that space to ensure, one, because we have a moral obligation to these people, but also we've sat and talked earlier today about workforce shortages. We can't afford to have people who could be in the workforce not to being there from an economic perspective.
Minister, I would, I suppose, seek reassurance, although these pathways to college and to employment are important, but community learning and development is also important for health, for, you know, tackling social isolation and loneliness. That aspect of it won't be lost, will it?
I give you that assurance, and I'm sorry, I apologise if I gave the wrong impression. Absolutely not. I did say at the start, for some people it's just about developing life skills which will help them tackle social isolation. On one of my visits, I met a group of older learners for whom simply becoming computer literate had made a huge difference to their lives. They felt much more engaged with society. And it's quite thought-provoking when you hear that, because we all take for granted, you know, go online, do this and that. If you can't do that, you become incredibly isolated in life. And one of the other pieces of work, which kind of ties into the CLD piece, I touched on earlier about the third sector organisations, the work that Enable are doing with young people in schools. You've got learning difficulties, for example, is hugely important. And I want to see what more we can do in that space, because there are some instances where they have access to work experience that's quite significant and meaningful. I've seen other examples where it's pretty limited. And I think we need to see what we can do to support and encourage employers to offer better opportunities for young people in that cohort.
Thank you. That reassurance is helpful. Moving on with the convener's indulgence, if I may, you spoke earlier about geographical and sectoral skills planning and shortages. On the Health, Social Care and Sport Committee at the moment, we're doing an inquiry into rural healthcare. And one of the themes that's cropped up a couple of times is lack of allied health professionals in rural areas. Several of the professional bodies spoke about the need to adapt the training for this and give suggestions that having earn as you learn apprenticeship type things for, you know, physiotherapists or for people advancing in other areas of allied health would be helpful, as people already have connections to the rural areas that they're in. They'll have a grounding in the organisations often. They identified the blockers as being, to that happening, as being the universities themselves. Would you have any reflections on that, as what would need to happen to change those types of offerings so that people within rural areas could, you know, progress on these pathways?
I'll give a very general answer to that, and I'll bring Jane in because I know she's cited on this. I'd be surprised that our universities were blockers to anything. The university's principals I engage with are very open to developing their offering, notwithstanding the fact that it needs to be financially viable to do that as well. Because if there's not a critical mass of students, it becomes very difficult to put together a course and then deliver it in a cost-effective way. But in a general sense, I find them very open to, and the kind of earn as you learn approach. There are a number of universities, Strathclyde, Glasgow, Cali, are very much developing that kind of graduate apprenticeship approach. And
before we go, I should probably say that's my language. When we ask what's stopping it, it's about how it's offered. I don't think necessarily anyone's being obstructive.
I should clarify that. But I'll bring Jane in because I know she's been working on this.
Okay, thanks, Minister.
If you hold on a second, Jane, it's my mic that's on, not yours. There we go.
Sorry. Can you hear me now? thank you, Convener, for that. We are in discussion with NHS Education for Scotland and the Scottish Funding Council and the Deans of Medicine about what we can do round about the healthcare sector, particularly on allied health professionals. I'll call them NES for short, NHS Education for Scotland. NES are working on a plan of what they already have in place, what courses are being offered, where the gaps are, and where there's maybe a requirement from the professional body that something is a degree. This is a specific example for Operation Department Practitioners, ODP, where the University of the West of Scotland had offered a diploma, which is slightly below a degree level course. And the registration body for ODPs has mandated that it should be a degree level course. So NES and some of my colleagues in health, myself, colleagues in the Scottish Funding Council, are working with the University of West of Scotland to develop a graduate apprenticeship, which will be degree level. And we're hoping to have that in place in this year. August this year, for the new cohort of people starting. Now, you talked specifically about rural. University of West of Scotland, despite being in the West of Scotland, actually deliver throughout Scotland. It's a relatively small cohort of people that you have going through the courses at the moment, which makes sense to consolidate it so that you've got economies of scale there. But they're very experienced in delivering in rural areas. And as we go through a 3-year pilot, we'll look at how we can expand that out and how we can make sure that University of Highlands and Islands, some of the colleges, for example, are involved in some of that activity. But this is one of our tests at the moment, and certainly universities seem very positive about this. If there are specific examples that anyone has about...
That was my language. Don't worry about that.
But we're grateful to hear where there are some blockages. But as I say, NES are very much looking at the workforce planning and looking at what's needed and where some of the gaps are.
And just briefly, speaking to the existing workforce, because I suppose that, and the Minister gave the example there of often people in the workforce know what needs to happen to progress. Is there opportunity to speak with,
with them? Yes, very much so. So NES and the health boards are speaking to their existing staff who are already going through the ODP route and some of the other routes about what would work for them, particularly for people who are working part-time and having to juggle that study and working as well. And shifts as well, how that will work. Also, when apprenticeships are developed, it's really important that the voice of the learner, the employee, is involved in that. So the graduate apprenticeship process will have practitioners fully at the heart of that as well. Okay. And, it's really important because they give us a perspective that, us that are not actually doing the job don't really understand.
Okay, thank you. Thank you, Convener.
Thank you. Can we come to Ben McPherson for a very brief...
Thanks, Convener. Just going back to the points, Minister, that you made around careers advice, I think of my constituency in Leith Academy, for example. They run a great programme where they bring lots of employers in to introduce young people to what's available in the local area there. Drummond Community High School specialises in construction. I was at Lothian Buses with a third sector organisation yesterday called Powering Futures and the apprenticeships that they're creating. So there's really good anecdotal work going on, and that's just in one constituency in Scotland. But how do we, to a reasonable extent, get to a position where there's a consistency in terms of introducing young people to the plethora of different opportunities that are available to them?
So that's some of the work that's been undertaken by the Careers Collaborative under Graham Smith. we need to expand upon that, because like you, I've seen some fantastic examples. But I want to be satisfied that that is available. So, for example, I attended a careers fair in Edinburgh. Hundreds of young people being bussed in to hear about the full range of offering. What I found particularly impressive was there was a separate section of the building for young people who perhaps had autism or whatever, who needed a quieter space to have those conversations, not the mayhem that was going out in the main hall. So a lot of thought going into how we met the needs of everyone here. And what we absolutely need to have is everyone doing their bit. So DYW do a particular role. We must maintain and support that. The career service needs to do what it does. There are no turf wars. It is everybody doing their thing in collaboration. And that is the easy bit of this is we're not starting from scratch. It's there. We just need to build on it and make it a more cohesive and consistent offering across the country. And I think that's where we can make giant strides.
Liam Kerr now, please. Thanks.
Thank you, Convener. Good morning, panel. Funding was brought up earlier, and I'd like to specifically ask about college funding. The Auditor General recently spoke to the Public Audit Committee and stated the viability of the college sector is challenged, and then went on, in order to address that challenge, the government and the funding council need to have a clear plan for what the future model of provision looks like. So, Minister, will there be such a plan? And if so, when?
So, I recognise the commentary from Auditor General. I also recognise the comment from Audit Scotland about the potential of the changes that we're making to improve the landscape in which the colleges are operating. What I would say to you, Mr Kerr, is that the future delivery in the college sector will be shaped by what we're doing in the reform space, and it will be shaped jointly between ourselves and the colleges, recognising the financial challenges that they face, absolutely, but also recognising the opportunity that they have here. So there's a short-term challenge financially, I fully accept that, but we need to move quickly into taking advantage of the opportunities that will be there fairly quickly for them. But of course there will be some difficult decisions. We're going to have to be realistic here. If we do not have sufficient numbers for a college course to be delivered in every locality, we may well need to move to a kind of centres of excellence model in some instances and support young people to make whatever travel they have to do that. I'm speculating here, but I think this is the kind of thinking we're going through at the moment about what is it we need to do to make the colleges more sustainable and viable, have a realistic offering, and one that aligns better with the needs of employers and the economy. There may be a pivoting away in some colleges to focus on something they haven't done up until now. We'll need to look at some of the courses as well. Are they absolutely fit for purpose for the needs of the evolving, particularly in green skills? And green skills don't just mean, you know, the fitting of solar panels or air source heat pumps. There's a joinery element to that as well. So, you know, have we got a plan for a plan immediately? No, but we're working towards having that direction for the colleges, help shaped by them as to what's going to make them more sustainable and viable. Is that?
Yes, it does. I know that one of my colleagues wants to explore this further. I'm just wondering, I'll carry on. In which case, on that exact point, so when you talked about the colleges becoming sustainable and perhaps becoming more specialised, I'm paraphrasing entirely, but James Withers has told this committee that colleges currently are, what he said was, a burning platform in relation to finance and sustainability, and he was worried there might be a more chaotic reorganisation of the sector based on the law of natural selection. Now, you've obviously painted a very different picture, which is much more drawn out and more managed. But is James Withers right to be concerned? And how can you reassure us, Minister, that such a chaotic reorganisation isn't in the offing?
I wouldn't use the language of burning platform, chaotic reorganisation, as you've articulated. But I do recognise there are challenges for some colleges. bigger challenges than others. And we are, William Rennie asked earlier on about the support for certain colleges that's being provided. We do need to support some colleges to move into that stronger space. The situation is not without its challenges, and I wouldn't pretend otherwise at the moment. But I do think that there's an opportunity to move quite quickly. And I'll give you an example of that. One of the conversations that we're having actively with the college sector is how we might move to more of a college's first model around apprenticeship delivery. That's a presumption that we would do more on a direct basis with colleges. Now, that doesn't mean we would do all of it directly through colleges. There are instances where managing agents are incredibly helpful and useful and play a worthwhile part. That in itself is believed by the colleges to provide greater opportunity for them to stabilise. Now, I have to stress that before I would make such a move or sanction such a move, I would need to be satisfied that the offering that was going to be made to those apprentices, holistically, not just in terms of the training, would be on a par with what they currently get. But we are having very open dialogue directly with the colleges about what we could do differently to give them that stability that they are rightly looking for.
And finally for me, you talked, Minister, about an opportunity to move quickly, and it sounds like there is that need. But the Strathesk Resolutions Lessons Learned report on national collective bargaining in colleges report was released on the 25th of March 2022, and that was a report commissioned by the Scottish Government. When does the Minister anticipate publishing a plan to take forward the recommendations that were in that report?
This is in the context of the industrial relations in the sector.
Right.
Yeah. I mean, you'll recognise that it has taken some time to secure the responses from all of the interested parties to allow us to come to a view. Now, the situation is, I think all of us around this table would recognise that the industrial relations in the college sector are not good and have not been good for a very long time. I can't impose anything on in terms of the bargaining structures. I'm not able to do that. But I do absolutely recognise that we cannot go on as we have been for years. We have a current industrial dispute going on. We need to get over that. And I think then, and I do think there is an appetite, there is a recognition that this cannot continue in the way it has. And I think if we can, sitting alongside all the reform stuff that we're doing, if they can find a way through the current industrial action, I think we draw breath and then look to consider how we do this differently. I have some views, but as I say, I can't impose those on the relevant parties.
I'm grateful for the answer. I'm just going to press you, Minister, on that specific report recommendation. So you said it took time to secure responses from the interested parties. So have you had all the responses from the interested parties? And in any event, can I just press you on when we might see, or are we going to see, a plan for her to take forward the recommendations, and if so, roughly when?
Well, as I said, I don't want to mislead. I think we now have, quite recently now, we have. That's my recollection. If I'm wrong, I'll write and correct the record. That being the case, as I've just alluded to, I think we need to see the various parties get over their current difficulty, and then we can take a look at what it is we could do differently. But it will require buy-in from all the parties to deliver that.
Very grateful.
Thank you very much, Minister and Mr Kerr. Pam Duncan-Glancy now, please.
Thank you, Convener. And thank you for answering the question so far. And I'm encouraged by the comments you've just made around the role of colleges and apprenticeships moving forward and the potential in there for some of the resource to be potentially more directed to colleges. This year, the Minister will be aware that there's a resource fall for colleges, and there's also the funding cut of about £100 million from Scottish Funding Council. So against that backdrop, can you set out how you expect colleges to respond to the Withers Review?
Well, let me just pick up that immediate point about the budget situation. If we take the starting point for next year for colleges, it will be slightly better and I stress only slightly better, than the finishing point this year. So the budget that was set out originally, as you've alluded to, there were funding changes made during the year. If you match what the colleges will have ended up with in this financial year, the starting point next year, we believe, will be slightly better. Now, I recognise there's inflation, etc., etc. But to the point that you allude to, of course, having less money in real terms, I accept that, does not help the situation. But I have to balance circumstance where we are where we are with the budget that's available to us. And what we are now going through, not just with the colleges, but with the university as well, is the SFC is going through a process with them over the next month or so, where we're looking at how that financial settlement is delivered in a way that, you might say, least harmful, but certainly in a way that better facilitates the challenges they face.
Thank you. And the Minister, you'll be aware, Minister, of the report that the SFC has done on the financial circumstances facing colleges, and I don't think they forecast that it will improve in the way that you've described. And the change mid-year, I think, has been significantly difficult for colleges, so I'm not sure they'd characterise it in that way either. Do you think that in order to respond to Withers in the way that you've described, much of which I'm heartened by, do you think colleges might need some additional funding in the outset, perhaps to make savings in the longer term when all the changes have been made?
Oh, it won't surprise you that I'm going to come back to you and say, well, from where? That is the issue that we have. If the argument is that colleges or any other element of the landscape would require some sort of initial pump priming support to make the changes that need to come, then it has to come from somewhere. And that is the immediate issue, the budget circumstances that we find ourselves in and with the public finances. But James Withers is also very clear in his report, there is no shortage of money in the system. And one of the things that I'm looking at, and it's not the main driver, but is where we can free up monies that are in the system to redeploy into areas where we need to support, if that becomes the area of focus. And I can't, if you're going to wait, I press me on, can you give me specifics? Mm-hmm. I can't right now. But that is one of the things that we're looking at. Where duplication, for example, where is there duplication that can be avoided? What would that free up, if it can free up monies? And that's part of it, the thinking that we're going through at the moment. And I can't say that's going to happen overnight, because it's not, but it is a driver for us at the moment.
I appreciate that. And I would have obviously pressed you on where you think that duplication is. But if that work is on... Well, first of all, is that work ongoing? Are you looking at where the duplication is? Mm-hmm. When would you be able to update the committee on where you think there's duplication of resource and you could move it around? And how do you think colleges can begin to prepare for the reforms that are suggested without all of that information and without the additional resources?
Well, I think colleges are preparing for the reforms. They absolutely are. I mean, the conversations that we are having, as I said, detailed conversations about a college's first model is an illustration of that. The colleges are absolutely planning for the opportunities that they see, notwithstanding financial challenges currently, but the opportunities they can see. It isn't, though, as simple as identifying duplication and saying, well, that's coming to an end, that frees up money. There is, in many instances, a kind of phasing approach that you need to take to that. And that's why I said there's not a magic wand here. It's not going to happen overnight. But we are looking very actively at where there is duplicated spend that I believe is avoidable. Because we have got priorities in all of this. I need to invest in that career service element. We need to beef that up if we're going to help our young people make informed choices. We need to support the colleges to do that kind of transitioning that they're going to have to do. Everybody's got an ask here, and that is probably one of the biggest challenges in all of the reform spaces, how we get into that momentum that we need to get into to deliver it, given the financial difficulties that are there.
So can I assume then that you we'd anticipate that any of the reforms that are suggested and taken forward will be within the current resource allocation. There'll be no additional resources.
In the short term, the immediate term, and I think that's a fair assumption. But we are at... So for example, there is an opportunity, I think, for colleges to get more into the commercial space as well in terms of that and work with employers. Mm-hmm. Can they generate more income through there? And, of course, within that, your point about the resource allocation is the work we're doing on the tripartite group. What can we do there to give them that bit of flexibility to operate in a different way that they believe, and I stress that they believe will help them cope with the current pressures? And that's the other piece of work that's going on.
Thank you. And that's just where I want to kind of end my question, which is on the flexibilities. Do you yet know the impact that any of the flexibilities you've already put into the system has had on colleges?
Well, I did say to you, this is not the flexibilities that put in during my tenure as Minister. I was quite open with the committee that the previous set that had been provided had not been fully exploited. And that's not a criticism of anyone, that's just the reality. Now, those flexibilities remain in place. I think we are better placed to exploit those, to take advantage of them currently. And we are in a dialogue about what more needs to be done. There's lots of little things that could be done to help the colleges operate in a freer way. And that's driving a lot of the conversations that are taking place. I did say that if we get to the point where there's something tangible we can report, and I get the agreement of the other participants to write to the committee and outline that.
Okay, thank you. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Minister, you made some bold statements regarding the overall college funding there, given some of the challenges they faced last year between the various budget statements and budget announcements that were made, including some of the £56 million in the savings and demand-led programme that was taken away, and then the £26 million that was also taken away to fund the teacher settlements. So what the colleges were left with was a £72 million removed from their budget. So who's to say that's not going to happen again?
I'm not quite picking that up, convener. And to be fair, I hope I wasn't making a bold statement. I mean, I hope I was very clear in what I said, which was that the money that they will have, we anticipate in the draft budget, them having to start in their core budget for the start of the new financial year, is broadly in line, slightly better, we think, than what they will have finished up with, excepting the in-year changes that were made.
But they were quite significant in-year changes that were. So who's to say that sort of in-year change pressure is not going to be placed upon this sector again?
Well, there are external factors that mean I can't sit here and say that absolutely wouldn't be the case. We're working very hard to avoid that. But for example, the UK government will have a budget at the beginning of March. If, as has been flagged, right way or wrong way, that is likely to focus on tax cuts, then that would have a negative impact on our budget. So I can't sit here and say, no, we're not. That won't happen again. I can't guarantee that. But what we're trying to do here is to be as open as we can with the colleges at the very outset and others, and proceed on that basis.
But the Scottish Government has taken a preferential to fund the public say settlement versus other decisions that are made. So I think we'll leave that
What we did, with respect, convener, I remember predecessors sitting here when I was a member of this committee making the point that for that particular purpose and others, the money would have to be found from somewhere.
And at that point in committee, the Cabinet Secretary didn't quite say where it was coming from, did she?
I think, to be fair, the then Cabinet Secretary wasn't in the position to do that at the time.
So, can I also ask, you know, in the past I've asked quite a lot of questions on the behalf of the college sector around when they might have some clarity around the Flexible Workforce Development Fund. And obviously, disappointingly for the colleges and for myself, you wrote to us on the 20th and 21st of December to confirm that has been cut. And I was just wondering around some of the decisions outside in terms of the priorities. I'm just trying to understand a bit more about how that decision was taken.
So we, as you know, have faced very considerable financial challenges. It had remained my hope that we would have been able to provide a fund of some degree for that purpose, very much right up and towards the end of the year. That ultimately proved not possible to do. I recognise the difficulty that presents, both for employers, for the colleges, and also the Open University, who utilised that fund. And of course, we've been unable in the draft budget to restore that fund for the coming year, in that form. So, you know, I can't hide from that, and I'm not going to. It's one of the very difficult decisions that's had to be taken. Do I recognise that in some guise, that type of funding, ideally we would want it to form part of the offering as we go forward in the context of the whole reform agenda?
In some of the conversations we had with Ross Greer questioning in terms of employers and some of the micro-credentials, do you think it might all be able to...
I think there's a conversation to be had with employers about what form that takes, what form... you know, where employers may be putting money into the system or whether we need to do something to assist that. I absolutely recognise that. I'm trying to be as open as I can be, convener. It's not an ideal situation that we're in, but I do believe that there will be discussions around that whole offering that we've talked about earlier and how that is delivered. And it may be that moving forward we need to find some mechanism of some kind to provide that opening for perhaps some employers.
Okay, thank you. Thank you for that. Stephanie Callaghan, thank you.
Thanks very much, Convener. Good morning, Minister. I want to ask about the Scottish Education Exchange Programme. Certainly losing Erasmus was a massive blow for us, and the SEEP is much needed. And I know that certainly when this committee took evidence on the Welsh TAFE Learning Exchange Programme, that we were quite impressed with that there. So I'm wondering, is that influencing the SEEP programme? Are they looking like they might be broadly similar, or are there any big differences? And are you able to offer any further detail around that programme just now?
Bear with me, I've got some detail on that and I'm trying to find it. Just trying to be as helpful
searching.
As possible. So we as you know, we embarked on a pilot project which was open to bids. I think there are circa 21 projects were successful. They were overwhelmingly successful. All from universities, I might add. We did extend the deadline to help facilitate more applications. Those are due to proceed over the next 3 months to then be assessed with a view to the next financial year. I'm grateful to all of those who helped shape the approach that's been taken. I think it'd be fair to say, if there was a criticism of it, is the timescale is pretty tight, and I think that's contributed to the number of applications that we've had. But I think that's happened in other places as well. And so the plan, as we sit here today, is to deliver those projects, assess the outcome with a view to what we do going forward. But bearing in mind that what we're looking to deliver is something that is complementary, supplementary to Turing. It's not a replication of that. And it's based along, as I said, grateful particularly to the universities who helped in progress that.
So could I ask as well then, is there a kind of timeline in mind just now then for it actually being rolled out? When is that likely to actually happen?
I think there's two things at play. One is you run pilot projects to identify their worth. I'm trying to think. I think most of the projects are European-based, but there are some that go into South Africa, for example, is one of the other projects. We would need to have an assessment of that fairly quickly, I recognise. And then I keep stressing, and I do mean this, I think the relationship and the dialogue between ourselves and the university sector is quite good. And everything that we're doing, for example, you know, we co-designed the international engagement strategy. It genuinely is, and we'll launch that shortly. So I'm not going to sit here today and say we'll do X or Y without having that input from college partner, university, and college partners in the context of the pilot scheme. So I don't want to avoid the question. I'll be happy to write with more detail in due course, but that's the path we've gone down.
No, that's quite helpful, and I think that collaborative approach and that flexibility going forward is incredibly important. I'm wondering, will the Scottish Government fully fund SEEP, or if not, how much will institutions and other partners be expected to contribute to that? Do you have any ideas around that at this moment?
I mean, that's a difficult question to answer because we don't know what a fully fledged SEEP would look like. The level of application to the fund was not particularly high, and I accept a lot of that was down to timing and the pilot nature of it. So it's difficult to gauge what the level of interest would be if we get it up and running, and therefore the associated cost. That is very much a work in progress, but I stress a joint work in progress.
I'm going to open up the last wee bit to any other questions, if anyone has. We've got a bit of time in hand. Pam, Duncan Clancy.
Thank you very much, Convener. And just on the SEEP programme, you said that 21 applications have been successful. Can you tell us anything about the number of other applications and what kind of sector they'd come from, whether it was youth work, college, schools?
I think they were all from the university sector, unfortunately. There weren't any from elsewhere. That's something we're obviously looking at. And again, it may have been the time scales. There was one institution withdrew its application. I think in total, and I stand to be corrected, there was only ultimately one, possibly two projects that didn't progress. There were 13... So all the projects funded at that stage were international in scope. 13 of them have European partnerships. And the funding ranged from involvement in the EU strategic network, short-term projects creating opportunities for disadvantaged groups. It's in its infancy. I fully accept that. But then you would expect that with a kind of pilot setup.
Absolutely. Can you tell us, have any students gone on exchange under the Scottish programme?
Given that this is January the 10th, I don't know is the answer. The pilot scheme runs from January to the end of March, but I do know there was quite a lot of planning going on. It may be the case, but I honestly can't answer that.
Thank you. And can I ask one further question, if that's okay? Very briefly. Is it your intention to keep or scrap the Apprenticeship Employers Board, SAB?
You mean SAB?
Yeah.
As I said to Ruth Maguire, it would be my intention to accept that recommendation, but I think also I was clear, but with a view to expanding quite markedly the employer's voice in the development of apprenticeships.
Thank you.
Thank you very much. Willie Rennie?
Colleges, there seems to be some ambiguity about exactly what their budget will be for the forthcoming year. And they are feeling that the world is very uncertain for them. I mean, in-year cuts significantly this year, uncertainty about next year. When you're trying to provide them with some direction, are you fighting their corner enough with the finance secretary?
Well, I certainly hope I am. You talked about ambiguity. I think the discrepancy, Mr. Rennie, is between rightly interpretation of what was on the face of the budget last year set against now. So that is a set of figures that are valid. What I'm articulating is the difference between what they will end up with in reality this year and where we will start off next year. It may be slightly better than I've said. We'll have to see how that's worked through. But of course, Mr. Rennie, as you well know, the budget process, it's open. There's an opportunity for other partners to pitch budget ideas, and I'm sure the Finance Secretary would be happy to sit down with the Liberal Democrats as previous Finance Secretaries and hear their thoughts. And that's not a challenge, it's just an observation. I mean, but in all seriousness, it is a very difficult situation financially. I do absolutely get how important colleges are to us. And, you know, within the difficulties that we face, the challenges that we face financially, we'll do everything we can to support our colleges.
Thank you very much. And I'd like to thank the Minister and his officials for their evidence this morning. It's been a very informative session. And that concludes our public part of our proceedings. I'll now suspend the meeting to allow the witnesses to leave, and the committee will then move into private session to consider its final agenda items. Thank you very much.